Wedged between Bhutan to the north and Bangladesh to the southwest is the Indian state of Assam. With 26 districts, the state whose annual rainfall ranks among the highest in the world, stretches for 450 miles along the fertile alluvial valley of the Brahmaputra River. The state is also hedged by the Himalayas to the north, and an amphitheater of four hills to the south and the east. The history of the early inhabitants of Assam goes back to 100 BC. The land, called Kamarupa then, was said to have extended for 450 miles from a shrine on the Nilanchal Hills in modern Guwahati. Though vague and indistinct, this history has come through a people whose identity has been shaped by wars, political infightings, and migrations. The Assamese, like the Indian Masala, is a mixture of different peoples, and one of the people groups in Assam that fits this description so well are the Assamese Muslims. The Assamese Muslims include invading Muslims who have been taken prisoner during wars and after their release decided to settle in the land. These are regarded as indigenes. In addition, there are those who migrated from other countries to work in the rice fields and tea plantations under the government's agricultural programs. And in recent times, there has also been an influx of illegal immigrants. Though the Assamese Muslims' ethnic origins may be varied, the people today have a sense of common heritage, perhaps bonded by religion and language. Being the majority group in six districts in Assam and accounting for about 32% of the state's 27 million people, the Assamese Muslim community has become a people to reckon with.
The present attitude of non-Muslim people towards Muslim is some kind of almost a fear, some kind of distrust because of their rapid expansion and rapid increase in number. And then there is a fear that they might try to convert the whole of Assam into a Muslim nation.
The Assamese Muslims are indeed growing, and so are their impacts on every aspect of the Assamese society and indeed the whole of India.
They are very enterprising, and in politics also, they are coming up in so many fields. Even from the Muslim community, they have produced the president of India.
Most Assamese Muslims dwell in the rural areas, but their impact in the cities is notable. From among those who have been in the land much longer, we have professionals and entrepreneurs in various fields, giving strength to the private sector, especially small-scale businesses. In addition, most Assamese Muslim craftsmen commute to the cities to look for work. They make up a good part of the artisans and traders of Assam.
Assam is called the land of lahe lahe, meaning slowly, slowly. But it is quite different with the Muslim people who are energetic, industrious, and hardworking. Wherever you have the Muslim community, you also have things cheaper. The Muslim community, they are very skillful in, you know, carpentry and masonry works, and then they provide labor force, and they have really made the Assam state prosperous.
Though the Assamese Muslims' industry could have been motivated by sheer survival instincts, since they were immigrants, they have nonetheless proved to be masters of the rugged Brahmaputra Valley. With over 89% of the state living in rural areas, it is not surprising that agriculture and agro-allied industries are the mainstay of the Assamese economy. Nearly 53% of the state's workforce is employed in this sector. With 17% of this workforce engaged in the tea industry, Guwahati, the state's capital, houses the world's largest tea auctioning center. Handicrafts, metal crafts, bamboo crafts, silk weaving, and other cottage industries also color the Assamese socio-economic landscape. One significant element on this landscape is the betel nut, grown and eaten everywhere. A daily companion, a digestive after meals, a customary refreshment for visitors, and above all, as one of the highest expressions of respect, when an offender offers betel nut in a bota and apologizes, the community is bound to forgive. The Assamese cultural heritage is renowned in India. From this richness, however, has emerged a culture that is very challenging to reach with the gospel. And the Assamese Muslims are a very religious people.
My people, the Assamese Muslims, take religion very seriously. Because of our history and social challenges, we have found mutual support in our religion.
The American Baptist missionaries came to Assam with the gospel in the year of 1836. But till now, there is not even a single church among them.
They have been neglected all these years. The church have not heard the call of the Muslim. There are many missionaries working among the tribals, but no one works so far among the Muslim.
The church in Assam has had difficulty reaching out to the Assamese Muslim community in the past. And this is not entirely because of a lack of interest or concern for the Assamese Muslim community, but more because of a lack of awareness or understanding how they can bridge the love of Jesus to the Assamese Muslims, and understanding the culture and context in which to reach them so that they could understand and embrace Christ as their Savior and as their Redeemer.
We belong to the Lion of Judah. We are Abraham's seed. We belong to the God and Creator of everything. Let us raise up the covenant chorus. Let us bring forth our lives to the one whose host gathers among us and fills the sky. Thank you. glory forever before His throne.
Indeed, things have begun to change.
The Assamese Muslims present one of the most unique and exciting missions opportunities in the world today.
My vision to reach the all Assamese Muslim people for the glory of our God, to work at the grassroots level, especially with the fundamental and learned Muslim people, bring them to Christ and also plant at least a few churches among them.
Though reaching the Assamese Muslims with the gospel has not been easy, God has been drawing them to Himself.
I heard a message of Christ through a radio ministry, and I took some interest to know more about Jesus Christ. Then I contacted with that radio ministry, and I obtained a New Testament from them. I had one Assamese Quran, and I started a comparative study of both Quran and New Testament. So more than 4 years I studied, and after the study I came to conclusion that Jesus Christ can be our best mediator to reach heaven. There are 3 points that I discovered reading the Quran and New Testament. So when I discovered these 3 points, both from Quran and New Testament, I was convinced myself and I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior.
I gave my life to Christ after reading the Quran and found out that Jesus Christ is the Savior. But more important to me, I have seen my life change, especially with the bad things my community did to me and to my family. I would have been very bitter, but now I love them even more. I pray for them. I know what is right or wrong before God. That wasn't how I was before.
Khurshid's and Rafiq's stories are by no means the only ones of such. Many other Assamese Muslims have also been experiencing God in very unique ways.
Recently, one person shared with me about his testimony, how God appeared to him, how God revealed himself to him, and how he is the true God. And this man became a new person. And likewise, I have heard also religious leaders from the Assamese Muslim community who have seen dreams, who have seen Jesus Christ, and who have decided to follow Jesus Christ.
I spoke to one of their leaders a few weeks ago after one of our meetings, and he told me, "We want to proclaim Isa al-Masih to our people." Then he asked me, "Are you the one God has sent to help us proclaim Isa al-Masih to our people?" After 2 weeks, I met this leader again, and during those 2 weeks he had gone out to over 16 different villages in 3 districts of Assam, visiting homes of Assamese Muslim and Muslim background people.
A couple months after that encounter, Michael's friend reports of the birth of many Jamaats, fellowships, across the districts of Assam, as many Assamese Muslims turn to Christ and get baptized. He also reports of a growing thirst and steadfastness of the new believers amidst growing persecution from family and community.
The situation we are in right now is a growing local, national, and international prayer movement that has been calling out the names of the Assamese Muslims for the last 5 to 10 years.
The church in Assam and the body of Christ across the world can step up this process of seeing the Assamese Muslims come to faith in Christ Jesus.
We see now many more people coming up, inquiring about Jesus Christ, who wants to know about the truth, about the gospel. And these are not ordinary people, but these are their social and political leaders and religious leaders.
A growing community of people are on the brink of receiving Jesus Christ as their savior. Pray for the strongholds of deception to be broken.
To pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to the hearts of the Assamese Muslim people.
Pray for the proper networking among different missions so that we can unitedly go to the Assamese Muslims and win them for Christ.
We need to see the Word of God translated into Assamese Muslim friendly language.
Pray that more laborers should be sent to the Assamese Muslim people.
Also need to pray for the contextualized literature.
Pray that God would send more people to train the Assamese Muslim believers to reach their own people.
Pray for enough rescue homes so that when the new believers come to Christ, we can accommodate them.
Pray for the Assamese Muslim community to be saturated with contextualized gatherings of believers
and support those who are working among the Assamese Muslims.
These are the Assamese Muslims, a people loved by God, and their time has come. Lift up your hearts and your hands as we team up to welcome these millions before the throne of the Lord of Lords.